Hi, today we are looking at another very interesting, very simple chapter in civics, the salient features of our Indian Constitution or the basic features of our Indian Constitution. There are certain aspects that you all have already looked at in the 6th and the 7th grade. We are going to revise those and zoom in on new elements. So come, let's start. The first important feature of our Indian Constitution is single citizenship. Now the name itself suggests single, one citizenship. So I could be born in any state, but I am known as an Indian. Okay? So for example, I could be born in Punjab, but I am known as the citizen of India. So this is what is single citizenship. That means that all the Indians, irrespective of the state where they are born, okay, we are looking at a new term, the state of domicile. So irrespective of the state of domicile, all are the citizens of India. Now this is unlike the system in the US. They can be citizens of the New York state as well as an American citizen. But in India, the framers of the Constitution decided to keep it as single citizenship. Now what was their rationale behind that? To push aside any kind of separatist tendencies, to promote fraternity, unity, develop respect, pride for the motherland, and create a bond of loyalty. However, by the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2003, the government of India decided to grant dual citizenship to all the people of Indian origin who migrated to other countries after 26th January 1950. Now they enjoy all the privileges as an Indian citizen except the right to vote. Let us move on to the next feature of our Indian Constitution. The next feature of our Indian Constitution is universal adult franchise. Now what does universal adult franchise mean? All the people above 18, irrespective of caste, creed, color, religion, race, gender, have the right to vote. Now, why was this put in? All the people have the right to vote, right? So what is the importance? What is the significance? It upholds unity, equality. Yeah? It fosters communal harmony. It curbs communal politics. And that is why the framers of the Constitution decided that the right to vote to all the Indian citizens is very, very important. Now, let us try and understand these two concepts, which are very, very important. There is something called as separate communal electorates or communal electorates, separate electorates. And there is something called as joint electorates. Now, when the Britishers ruled over India, there were times when they promoted communal hatred and all. They kind of went in for separate electorates. That means representative of only that particular community could contest elections. Seats were reserved and they could be elected by only the community of voters belonging to that community. So that was separate electorates. When we became republic, when we got our independence, the framers of the Constitution decided that the first thing that has to be done is we need to change this system, and they decided to go in for joint electorates. Now what does the word electorate mean? The people having voting rights, the power in the hands of the people to vote, they are called as electorates, okay? Now, joint electorate means what? That is the group which elects is made up of all the citizens who can vote as Indians together, not as belonging to separate communities. So the entire population votes for any candidate who is contesting the elections. So this is what is universal adult franchise. Let us move on to the third feature of our Indian Constitution. The third important feature is fundamental rights. Now you already know what are fundamental rights. They are the basic human rights which every Indian citizen enjoys once again, irrespective of caste, creed, color, religion, gender. Now this is very important for the all-round development of personality. So if I ask you, why are fundamental rights universal in nature? What are you going to say? Fundamental rights are meant for the all-round development of all, irrespective of any discrimination, caste, creed, religion, gender, for the all-round development of personality, and therefore fundamental rights are universal in nature. Now let us quickly look at the classification of fundamental rights. It has to flow in the particular order. You cannot break the order. To your good fortune, apart from 2-3 articles and 2-3, you know, important elements, we are not going to remember the article numbers related with each fundamental right, but at least you have to remember the flow in which the classification is done. Alright, so let us look at the 6 important fundamental rights provided in our Indian Constitution. First thing is right to equality. Next, right to freedom, right against exploitation, right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, and finally, right to constitutional remedies. Now, what we are going to do is, we are going to zoom in on each fundamental right in detail and then move ahead to the other features of our Indian Constitution. So let's start zooming in on each category of the fundamental rights. Under the fundamental right, right to equality, what can we see? Equality before the law. It guarantees equality before the law, equality in protection by the law, irrespective of caste, creed, gender, religion, race. Now, what does this mean? Equality before the law and equality in protection by the law. Now, equality before the law, that means I could be a clerk, I could be an important official, I could be a person from a very, very poor economic strata of the society, but I will be treated equally in the eyes of law. And equal protection by law means just because I am a poor person doesn't mean that justice is denied. Next, it also speaks about pushing aside, prohibiting any kind of discrimination on the grounds that I mentioned, caste, creed, gender, religion, race. It calls for equality of opportunity in matters relating to employment. Now out here, the government can carry out some kind of positive discrimination and can reserve seats for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Next, it speaks about abolition of untouchability and its practice in any form. That means a person cannot stop another person from entering a public place of worship or using a public well, using some kind of public transport. If the person is doing so, then they can be punished by law. And the last thing that comes under the right to equality classification, under that we have abolition of titles. Now, earlier titles that the Britishers had given, like Rai Sahib, Khan Bahadur, Maharaj, all those titles are considered as a negation of equal status for all. And therefore, the constitutional framers decided to abolish those titles. But they were very careful and they said that titles that people receive in the fields of sports or academic honors or for military service, that will not be abolished. That does not come under negation of equal status. So that can continue. So we saw the right to equality. Let us move on to the next classification of the fundamental rights given in part 3 of our Indian Constitution. Under the next classification of fundamental rights, we have right to freedom. Now, in this article number 19 is something that you have to remember. Now, this article 19 guarantees 6 different freedoms to the citizens. Now, what are those freedoms that are granted? Freedom of speech and expression, freedom to assemble peacefully without arms, freedom to form association and unions, freedom to move freely throughout India, freedom to reside and settle in any part of India, freedom to practice any profession, trade or business. Now, how will you remember this in the order? Okay, so we will first remember the article number 19. Okay, it is considered as the backbone of this entire element, right to freedom. Now, out here, which are the basic freedoms that it is granting to the citizens under Article 19? So, let's take a very small example. In Shishuvan, we are providing you the platform of speech and expression during the time of assembly. So, that is the first thing that we are going to keep in mind. Alright? So, speech and expression. Then, during assembly time, you all assemble, enter the hall, then you all form associations and start talking, then when the teacher comes, you all start moving around the place, then you all decide wherever you all want to settle and you all reside and settle in that part of the hall, and then people practice any profession that you want. So some complete their sleep, some are more interested in troubling the person sitting in front of them. Yeah. So out here, you all practice the profession of your choice or carry out the business trade of your choice. So out here, you have the basic freedoms granted in Article 19. Now, under freedom of speech and expression, the freedom of press is also included because it is showing a wider expression of freedom of expression. So the freedom of press is included in the wider form out here. And even the RTI, that is right to information, is a part of this. Now, why is it indirectly a part of the freedom and the Article 19 that we are talking about? Because the right to freedom of speech and expression. Now, if I do not know the facts, I will not be able to speak freely. Therefore, the right to information has been included in this Article 19. Now, any citizen can file an application under right to information with public information officers or assistant public information officers and seek for required information. All right. So this is the first important element under right to freedom. Next one is protection in respect of any kind of conviction. Now, what does conviction for offense mean? That conviction means a judgment of guilt in the court or proved guilty. Now, I am given protection. Why is that so? So when the constitutional framers were framing the constitution, they took inspiration from other constitutions and they realized that all those other countries had given the provision. Why? Because till I am not found, to be guilty and my offense is not proved, I am to be considered innocent. Okay? So out here, they have kept certain rights for even those people who are getting convicted for any kind of offense or the judgment is going on in the court. Now, there are three things that you have to keep in mind. That is, a person cannot be given greater penalty than what is prescribed under the law. That means, if I have committed a crime in say 2020 and the law states that for this crime I have to pay 5,000 rupees as a fine. Okay. Now, because the case is going on over and over, a number of years have passed and it has entered 2023. Okay. Yet the case is going on and the government has passed a new law that for this particular offense, the fine that will be imposed is 15,000 rupees. Now, just because the law has changed over a period of time, I cannot be given greater penalty than what is prescribed by the law, because I committed a crime in a different year and the law keeps changing, so they have given even that kind of protection. Second is, nobody can be punished for the same offense twice. Means, if I have, supposing, kidnapped Mr. X, yeah, and there is a case going on, I have been given punishment, yeah. Now, for the same kidnapping case of Mr. X, I cannot be given another punishment. But if I once again go on a crazy kidnapping spree for some reason and I kidnap Mr. B, now then I can be punished again. Yeah. So this, I cannot say that once kidnapping done, once punishment given, I can carry as many kidnappings as I want. No. But what does it mean? For the same offense, I cannot be punished twice. Okay. Now, the third thing is that a person cannot be compelled or forced to be a witness in a case where he himself is accused of the offense. Now, what does this mean? That I cannot be forced to provide any statement or any evidence that might put me in danger of proving that I was there in that crime. Now, I cannot say that I am not giving a fingerprint impression to the police. They want to check that they have found a murder weapon. Yeah, and they want to check. So, I cannot say that, you know what, I will not give my fingerprint testing. Why? Because I am being protected. No. So, there are certain things, there are certain exceptions, but overall, I cannot be forced to make statements or give evidence to show that I am guilty of a crime. So, no person can be bound to accuse himself of the crime. So, I can try different ways of trying to prove myself innocent in front of law. The next thing that we talk about is protection of life and personal liberty. Now, under this, right to education has also been added. Now, what does this say? A person cannot be deprived of his life and liberty unless it is in sync or in accordance with the law. And now, right to education has officially been added as one of the fundamental rights, right to freedom. Under right to freedom, protection of life and personal liberty, one more sub article has been added. Next one that we are looking at is protection against arrest and detention. That means, in normal circumstances, when I am getting arrested, I have the right to be informed, what have I done wrong, why is the arrest taking place. I have the right to consult a lawyer, prepare for my defense. I have to be presented before a magistrate within 24 hours of the time of arrest. Now, this is something very important, that I have rights even when I am getting arrested. And the next thing, protection against arrest, there is something called as preventive detention. Now, what does detention mean? To hold back. Now, preventive detention means that in anticipation that somebody might do something, I am keeping the person in custody. Now, even when I am using this preventive detention, it cannot be done in an arbitrary manner. Yeah, max to max, the person can be kept in custody for a period of 3 months without trial, but yet the person has rights. So, it does not mean that the person is accused, it is just a precautionary measure. The detention beyond 3 months can be extended, but only if an advisory board is giving permission to do so. Even the person who is detained has to be informed on the grounds why has he been detained, but there are certain limitations. Now, if at all the police get some intel that Mr. X is getting into terrorist activities and all, and he is going to do some big terror action, all right? Now they cannot wait till the terrorist completes the action. Now preventive detention means they will catch him and put him behind bars. So preventive, stop him, yeah. But the person is not accused at that point in time till they prove things. It is a precautionary measure. But so I said that the grounds of detention have to be specified, whatever. But there are limitations to this. Now, because of any kind of public interest, the authority of the state can refuse to disclose and share the grounds of detention. Yeah, the parliament has the power to specify the maximum period of preventive detention depending on the case that is involved. So all these are different elements that come under right to freedom. Let us move ahead. The next fundamental right is right against exploitation. So this right upholds the dignity of the individual. It prohibits exploitation in the form of slavery, or it could be begging, or it could be forced labor. So it provides freedom from all these elements. It stops the trafficking of human beings, that is buying of human beings, selling of human beings as if they are products in the market. And very important, Article 24, this article prohibits employment of children below the age of 14 in factories, mines, any other hazardous occupations. So out here, once again, article number 24 is important. Just like we saw article 19, the six basic freedoms, like this, article 24 is very important. So, right against exploitation, please don't make an error. And since you have right to equality, right to freedom, please don't turn it into right to exploitation, because that changes the entire meaning of the statement. So, please be a little careful when you are writing this. It is right against exploitation. Let us move ahead. Now the next fundamental right is right to freedom of religion. Now what does right to freedom of religion say? I have the right to freely practice, profess, preach, propagate the religion of my choice. And in order to promote my religion, I can establish and maintain religious institutions. I can acquire, that is gain, some kind of property to promote my religion. I cannot be compelled and forced to pay taxes to promote any particular religion. And if there is an educational institution that is giving some religious instructions, then I cannot be forced to attend such a thing. All right. So out here, I have full freedom of religion. Now, this is very important because we are in a country like India where secularism is very, very important. So this fundamental right shows that India is secular in nature. Let us look at the cultural and educational rights. Now under this, it gives the rights to the minorities to preserve their language, their script, their culture. It also gives all the minorities the right to establish and to administer educational institutions of their choice. Now, please don't get confused just because you see the word educational out here. Right to education is very, very different, okay, which speaks about free compulsory education to all the children age 6 to 14 years that has been added when we discussed about protection of life and personal liberty. And I said that an article has been added under this. Okay, now that is very, very different. And cultural and educational rights, the key word is in the word culture, that is minorities have the right to establish educational institutions to protect their culture, to conserve their culture. Now let us look at the last most important fundamental right, that is right to constitutional remedies. Article 32 of our Indian Constitution contains the right to constitutional remedies, and it is so important that Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar described this article as the heart and soul of the Constitution. Just like I told you, Article 19, the 6 different freedoms that I spoke about, it's like the backbone of our Part 3 of the Constitution, that is the fundamental rights. Similarly, out here, this is the heart and soul, the very essence. Why? Because if we have fundamental rights and if they are violated and we can't do anything about it, then it doesn't have any meaning. So we are going to look at a new term. That means fundamental rights are justiciable. Now, what is this new term, justiciable? In simple sense, a person can be dragged and taken to court if the fundamental rights are violated. And how can this be done? By issuing something called as writs, W-R-I-T-S. So I want you to see the names as I have put across on the screen out here. So which are the different writs? Habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, certiorari, quo warranto. Now you might be hearing these terms for the first time, don't worry. You just have to remember 2-3 key elements and move ahead. Now what is this writ? Writ is an official written order by the Supreme Court, High Courts, to give legal remedies to whom? To those individuals who do not get adequate protection and their fundamental rights have been violated. So let us look at this first writ of habeas corpus. What does habeas corpus literally mean? To have the body. When can this be used? If a person is unlawfully detained by any person or by the state, this writ is issued. And it is like a great safeguard for the personal freedom of a citizen. So if I ask you, name the writ that acts as a safeguard for personal freedom, that writ is habeas corpus. Now this is very important. To give you an example, if supposing Mr. X, he was to be detained, kept in prison for 5 years. What the police officials have done, they have extended it and they have illegally detained him, held him back, and they are not releasing him at all. At that point in time, the writ of habeas corpus can be produced and used, and the person has to be released if the person is unlawfully detained, unlawfully held back. The next one is mandamus. What does mandamus mean? We order. Now, as the name itself suggests, mandatory. That means it is like an order, a command from a superior court to a lower court or a particular authority to perform a certain duty. Now, I'm not taking the name of the case out here. I'm just giving you the summary of that case. It so happened that a financial corporation agreed and they said that we are going to give so many crore rupees to this particular hotel to carry out their infrastructure and redevelopment work. So that hotel started the work, but that financial institution refused to release funds later on. Okay. Now the writ of mandamus was issued, and what happened? The administrative authority was reminded that you have promised, it is your duty to provide the funds. Now you cannot back down. Alright. So this is the example of mandamus. Yeah. Compulsory. We are ordering you to do something, perform your duty. Next one is writ of prohibition. Now, as the name itself suggests, you are stopping something from taking place. Now, when can this writ be issued? Now, this is issued by a superior court to a lower court to stop its proceedings. इफ एट ऑल इट इज गोइंग बियॉन्ड इट्स ज्यूरिसडिक्शन. वॉट इज ज्यूरिसडिक्शन? इट इज अ लिमिट विद इन विच द कोर्ट कैन एक्सरसाइज इट्स पावर्स एंड फंक्शंस. सो इफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट रियलाइजेज दैट यू नो वॉट द लोअर कोर्ट हैज गॉन बियॉन्ड इट्स लिमिट्स, बियॉन्ड इट्स पावर्स, it has gone beyond its excess of jurisdiction, immediately it is asking the lower court to stop the proceedings of the case. Okay, so the case is going on and this is the action is going on and they are stopped right there. Okay, now the writ of certiorari is a little in sync with the writ of prohibition, but don't get confused. Writ of certiorari means to be informed what is going on. Now this writ is issued after the order has been passed by the lower court. Now are you able to identify the difference between writ of prohibition and writ of certiorari? How do I remember certiorari? Certificate, similar sounding. Now when do I get a certificate? After I complete the course. That means I have finished giving justice, the case decision has been taken, the court has passed the order, and then the Supreme Court is asking to, you know, to be informed what is going on, and then it looks into the proceedings. But what is prohibition? The discussion is going on, the case is on, and it is stopped. Okay, so I hope you have got the difference between certiorari and writ of prohibition. And final one is the writ of quo warranto, means by what order. This is issued when a person has snatched away, taken away any office wrongly or forcibly. Now all these writs are very important. As I said, they make it an effective tool for the enforcement of fundamental rights. So without the tool, we will not be able to protect the fundamental rights. So if we revise and if we see writ of prohibition, stop the proceedings if it's going outside the jurisdiction. Mandamus, we order, that means certain duty has to be performed. Then writ of certiorari, issued after the order is already passed. Quo warranto, if the seat or if the office is wrongly or forcefully snatched away. And habeas corpus, if a person has been unlawfully detained at that point in time, this writ is used. So all these five writs protect the fundamental rights. We will stop our discussion for today out here. There is no documentation to be done for this session. Other aspects related to fundamental rights, that is right to property that was deleted, when can fundamental rights be suspended, what are the restrictions on the fundamental rights, I will be discussing that in the next session. Along with that, we will in the next session look at the fundamental duties, and we will look at something called as directive principles of state policy next time. Till then, bye. See you.